think we'll get started. Good morning, everybody. Thank you. Good morning and welcome. My name is Zachary Goldman. I'm the Executive Director of the Center on Law and Security, and I wanted to thank you all for joining us here this morning. And my job right now is just to very briefly preview what today will look like. The focus of the conference, as you know, is the intersection of national security law and national security strategy. In the last decade, these two disciplines have become marbled together as never before, thrusting courts into new roles, giving executive branch legal advisors new responsibilities, and putting new kinds of pressures on the national security press corps. Specific ways in which these institutions have responded is going to be at the heart of today's discussion and is very much the core focus of our work here at the center. During the first of this morning's sessions, we'll be hearing from an extraordinary group of judges from four liberal democracies, Canada, Israel, the United Kingdom, and the United States, who will discuss what the adjudication of national security questions looks like in each of those jurisdictions. But before we're honored with their thoughts, I will turn over the podium to our Dean, Trevor Morrison, who will introduce this morning's keynote speaker, Chris Inglis, the Deputy Director of the National Security Agency. Thank you again for coming.
Thanks, Zach, and good morning, everyone, and welcome. Let me add my own welcome to Zach's, to all of you for coming. This is a really tremendously exciting day for us at the law school. The work that's been put into the center's hosting of this conference on law and strategy in an era of evolving threats is a tremendous amount of work, frankly, and the results are just wonderful. We're so thrilled to have this incredible cast of leading thinkers and practitioners and adjudicators in this space. I think it's just a testament to the work of the center and to, frankly, the unique position that we are in here at the law school to be able to bring together not only leading academic thinkers about this important set of issues, but judges with experience working on these issues, people currently and previously in government, in the executive branch in particular, who've worked on these issues as legal advisors and in developing policy and even operation in this space. That linking together of diverse expertise is really what we try and do here at the law school in all areas, and I think the center on law and security is the leading center of its kind in the country precisely because of its ability to draw together communities like this for important conversations like this one today. So it's my great pleasure to welcome you. My job, my specific job this morning, is to introduce Chris Inglis, who will start this morning's proceedings. Chris is the Deputy Director of the National Security Agency, and we are thrilled to welcome him here today. Chris is a graduate of the U.S. Air Force Academy and holds advanced degrees in engineering and computer science from Columbia University, Johns Hopkins University, and George Washington University. He first joined the NSA as a computer scientist within the National Computer Security Center, where he worked on issues of information assurance, among others, and was then promoted to the NSA's Senior Executive Service, in which he held a variety of senior leadership positions before taking his current role as deputy director, in which capacity he guides strategy, operations, and policy. He's also had a distinguished military career, which includes 9 years of active service with the Air Force and 21 years in the Air National Guard, from which he retired as a Brigadier General in 2006. I personally want to thank Chris for joining us here today. I think we will benefit greatly from his thoughts. We're grateful for his time, especially given the many other demands on his time these days, and it's a real pleasure for me to welcome him here this morning.
Good morning, everyone. My name is Sam Rascoff. I'm the faculty director of the Center on Law and Security. And once again, our warmest welcome to our conference today devoted to exploring the themes of national security oversight in relation to an evolving national security threat picture and evolving national security strategy concerns. Where else but at the Center on Law and Security does one follow up a riveting presentation by the Deputy Director of the National Security Agency with a panel of most distinguished jurists from across the liberal democratic world. I would assert that the answer to that is nowhere other than here today. And that in itself is, in my view anyway, worth the price of admission. I'm hugely honored to be the moderator of this first panel this morning, which is going to be devoted to exploring the role of courts around the world, constitutional courts, and their role in overseeing emerging national security issues. Let me very briefly introduce the members of the panel. I emphasize the very briefly because fuller biographies are available in the written literature that you have at your fingertips. But I'll say, starting from the furthest to my left, Justice Brian Francis Kerr, a member of the Supreme Court of the United Kingdom, became a member of that court in 2009, originally hailing from Northern Ireland. Prior to serving on the Supreme Court, he had served as the Lord Chief Justice of Northern Ireland and became Northern Irish Law Lord subsequent to that. We're most honored to have Justice Kerr with us this morning. Judge Brett Kavanaugh joins us from the United States Court of Appeals from the District of Columbia Circuit. Judge Kavanaugh has been on that court since 2006. Prior to which he had a very distinguished career in the executive branch of government and served himself in the Office of Solicitor General, as well as in the White House, working, among other things, the issues of national security. Sitting next to Judge Kavanaugh is retired president of the Israeli Supreme Court, Dorit Beinisch, who is also the Weinstein Family Distinguished Fellow at the Center on Law and Security. Justice Beinisch served as the president of the Israeli Supreme Court from 2006 to 2012, prior to which she was a member of that court since December of 1995. Before serving as a justice on the court, Justice Beinisch had a long and very distinguished career in the Ministry of Justice in Israel, where, among many other issues, she focused her practice on representing the State of Israel on national security matters. And sitting next to Justice Beinisch is Justice Rosalie Abella from the Supreme Court of Canada, who has been on that court since 2004. Among the many distinctions of Justice Abella's career is her service prior to her time on the Supreme Court as the sole commissioner of a royal commission that inquired into the nature of equality in employment, an issue concerning which her commission reported out findings that subsequently became the law of the land in Canada and across the Anglo-American world. So if you've gotten a sense, based on my very brief presentation thus far, that we, or I, am surrounded on this dais here by most distinguished jurists, then I think you got the right impression. Our conversation this morning is going to be about many things, but it's centrally going to be about one thing. So why don't I, before I take a seat and kind of commence a conversation, why don't I say what I think that one thing is? I think the one thing that we're really thinking about collectively this morning is this. What is the proper role of a constitutional court in relation to the oversight of national security? As you all heard from Chris Inglis this morning, there's a range of actors who might lay claim to being overseers of national security nowadays, from legislators to executive branch lawyers to members of the press, and we'll get lots of perspectives on these other actors throughout the day. But what is the role of a constitutional court? So why don't I begin as generally as that? What is the role of a constitutional court in relation to the oversight of national security? Turn it to the panel.
Just because we're all so shy, I thought I would get the conversation going. And so let me start by, first of all, thanking NYU for inviting all of us. We are friends, everybody on this panel. Brian Kerr and I met in Belfast 145 years ago. Actually, I'll tell you a story. It was very interesting for me because this Royal Commission that I did brought me to Belfast because Northern Ireland was implementing the recommendations, and I met Brian. And it was an intriguing ability to see what it was like for judges to have to deal with national security issues in the moment. And Dorit Beinisch, of course, has been in exactly the same place. And how did I know that? I arrived, I was a judge, and there were two security guards waiting for me at the airport in Belfast, and I said, what are you doing here? And they said, well, they kill judges in Belfast. Oh, I said, somebody could have told me that before I arrived. So there we were, the two professors, one from Queens, one from Ulster University, and the two security guards, and I said, look, I'm really sorry, guys. I got a rip in my pantyhose. I have to go get some pantyhose before we do anything. I had a lecture in an hour. So they took me to this grocery store. I got my pantyhose. At the end of the 48 hours that I was there, of course, I became friendly with security guards. You do that when you spend 48 hours. And they told me, they confessed to me as they put me on the plane, we told all the security guards in Belfast that there was a judge from Canada, and the first thing the judge wanted to do was buy pantyhose, and we never told anybody it was a girl. So
just as I asked, what is the role of the court in relation to the oversight of national security? And let me just say one more thing, maybe, just to kind of offer a little bit more kind of guidance on this. One view might have been, and a view that had we been sitting here in September of, let's say, 2001, on the first of the month, one view might have been, and this might have been a parochial American fascination even back then, but it might have been characteristic even more generally of at least some of the jurisdictions that are represented on this dais. One view might have been, you know what, such as there are issues of war and peace and foreign affairs, the court's role is fairly diminished. The role of the court is obviously is a very great when it comes to the adjudication of constitutional issues that present themselves in other contexts, but as to these sorts of issues, the role of the court is not necessarily as prominent. And I think that we can all agree, sitting where we are today, that whereas the question of how much the court ought to be involved, or in exactly what ways the constitutional court ought to be involved in the oversight of national security are very much open to question, and I gather that that's what we're going to be talking about for the next hour and change, that the very threshold question of if a court should be involved in these kinds of questions has been asked and answered. So that's my provocation to future thought.
Right, so let me then get down to what we're really here to talk about. We spend a lot of time thinking about what our role is, period. And when you think about what your role is, period, as a constitutional judge, you put the context of security into that role. You don't say, what is my role in security purposes different from what my role is from other constitutional issues? So what is our role? Our role is to, A, look at what's before us. What is the law that applies? What is the evidence that applies? What are the arguments that are made? Two, having weighed all of that, and security is no different except that it has the element of skepticism and fear. But I would argue that those are healthy elements in any constitutional adjudication. And so we come to a decision knowing that what we decide may very well be unpopular. And I stress that because I think that's the most important role for a constitutional court, especially a Supreme Court, in the area of security. Because you have the public saying, protect our interests from terrorists. You have people who have a long-term transcendent interest in justice saying, protect our rights. And the ability to protect rights often confronts public perceptions of what a judge should do. I think it's very hard to explain to the public that, yes, we are letting these people get a new hearing because their rights to due process were violated. But the real test, I think, of a judge is time. And if you look at the history of what constitutional courts have done over time, what's intriguing is that post 9/11, I think all of the constitutional courts, certainly the courts represented here, have been more sensitive to the rights issues than they were before we had 9/11. It's quite ironic. In Canada, for instance, until 1982, the courts almost always rubber stamped what was in the interest of the security players. Because we got a constitution in 1982, It is now very difficult. We scrutinize every aspect of the procedural rights, the justice rights, on the theory that we will listen to the evidence as we do, we will accept some expertise, but at the end of the day, we have to be judged over time that we are doing the right thing in the cause of justice. And that isn't just the justice of the moment, it has a long-range lens on it. So how to protect ourselves from the agitations of the moment, I mean, we do that every time we do a criminal case. Where the public wants us to make sure that they are protected from somebody they think is guilty, and we measure for the kinds of justice trappings that constitutional courts know are important for our long-range integrity.
President Beinisch?
Well, first of all, I agree with Justice Abella that the question is not what is the role of a court on national security, but what is the role of the court in our democratic systems? And national security, from that point of view, is not different. Maybe the balance may change, but this is the role, the oversight of it is of security matters, balanced in with civil liberties, is a part of the role of a court in every democracy. Now, I think it's not ironically that after 9/11, Rosie, your courts became more aware for that, because the legislatures in the democracies we serve took steps, legislature took very extreme steps reacting to 9/11. And I think they took too much. And then the courts realized what's happening and how civil rights are impaired because of this scare. And this was very exaggerated, I must say, by legislators. Now, we in Israel, unfortunately, have an experience of encountering problems of national security from the day that the state exists, actually. It's not new for us. We know it, and I must say, I'm not happy about it, but I think we have the most, more experience than any other court, because we had to. This is not new for us. Reality became different after it wasn't national existence security, but it was terror all over. We had our 9/11 for years, almost every day. So it became so central, this problem of civil rights, when you have counterterrorism war, where you have so much concern about security. It became a central issue in our lives. If courts would refrain from overseeing what's happening, I think we would all be exposed to very extreme rules and limits that would limit our rights. And this is, of course, unacceptable. So as you said, Rosie, it's not popular. I don't really know now in the situation in the United States, maybe it would be popular to be against security institutions. But normally, people want to feel safe, so they say the security, it's like a magic word. It's not a magic word. We might really see, even if security agencies have very good intentions, they really, and I agree, they work with a lot of dedication to achieve security. Conditions are not simple. The work is very difficult, very hard. And with all those good intentions, they really want maximum security. And in a democracy, you don't have maximum security. You have to pay a price. And the price is to balance and to remember that security is important, but our rights as citizens of the same system are very important too. So this is, in my view, the role of a court. And that's why it's very difficult for me to accept the American notion, I'm sorry to be criticizing, of so much thresholds, bars, that really caused the courts not to touch many of the serious issues of security that are, that you really have problems. But I think, and we, and your court in Canada, and in Britain too, I think not anymore really apply those thresholds arguments to avoid the oversight and the judicial review of security matters.
Judge Kavanaugh, maybe I could turn to you. I mean, one view that's prevalent is that the United States, in relation, let's say, to the other jurisdictions represented on the dais this morning, that the United States or that American courts, the American Supreme Court, your court, are more prone to deciding issues of national security on the sorts of threshold questions that President Beinisch just referenced just now. There's another view that says that there's been an unprecedented level of confrontation within the American courts on the merits of all sorts of national security issues over the last 12 years. So which view do you subscribe to, or how would you think about the role of the court more generally?
Well, first of all, thank you, Sam, for leading this panel and organizing this conference. Thank you to Dean Morrison for having us at this great law school and this center, which has done so much great work and is poised to do even more significant work in the future. I'm honored to be with the other members of the panel. On the question, the proper role of the courts in this new era. So we're talking about this new era, really, September 11th, of course, the central day in this era, September 11th, 2001. At that time, I was working at the White House. I was in the counsel's office. And what I remember a lot about September 11th is September 12th and coming to work on September 12th, which was so much different than going to work on September 11th in the White House. Things like education policy and stem cell research and tax reform, which were dominant in what we were thinking about, were still important, but obviously far less significant part of the president's time. I've said before, I think when President Bush came to the Oval Office on September 12th, after no doubt a night of no sleep, his mindset, I would gather, was this won't happen again. And as the country moved on, I think for him, just one person's view who worked there for 5.5 years, every day was September 12th for the next 8 years. And I think because he recognized in our constitutional structure, the president is uniquely responsible for the security of the United States and will be uniquely blamed if anything goes wrong. And I think understanding the central role of the president explains a lot of President Obama's continuity on many things with President Bush, because I think when he got in that chair on January 20th, 2009, he felt that. But the mindset was never again, or we're going to do everything we can to prevent it from happening again. To have, as Michael Hayden used to say, to have chalk on the toes, on your toes. In other words, tell me what the legal line is, and we, executive branch, are going right up to that legal line to defend the security of the United States. And the question then becomes, well, what are those legal lines? Where are those lines? And as a judge, as I've been for 7 years, how do we approach our role in determining what those lines are? I believe very deeply in the vision articulated by Chief Justice Roberts that judges should be umpires and should strive to be umpires. It doesn't mean that every case is easy, but that does mean our job is to find what the lines are. And there's a sense, as Sam said, that courts actually stay out of national security. That's one perception. Turns out, one of the things we ask in this new kind of war, I tell students to always ask about anything, how has it been done before? It turns out courts have been involved in the United States in wartime cases throughout our history. One of the three or four most significant cases in U.S. history is the Youngstown case in 1952, where the court took a very intrusive role in preventing President Truman from what he thought was an effort to successfully prosecute the Korean War. So courts have been involved throughout our history, and I think you start with that. Okay, the courts have a role. And then what is that role? The role, as has been stated, I think the role turns out to be very similar to the role in other cases. That's one of the most interesting aspects, I think, of being a judge. It turns out in national security cases, what I'm trying to do is figure out what the statute says. And there are lots of statutes that regulate what the executive branch does. And in those cases where there is a justiciable case, I know that's an issue that's been raised, but we have a lot of them, what does the statute say? And for courts to try to figure out the meaning of the statute and to apply that. We don't simply say, oh, the statute means this, but we're going to defer to the executive branch and allow it to blow through that statutory line. You see that in the Supreme Court in the Hamdan case, most prominently about the use of military commissions. So I think on constitutional cases, there are fewer constraints, but you see in a case like Hamdi, due process restraints, or Boumediene, habeas corpus restraints on the executive. The courts applying traditional principles of law in the Constitution or in statute to the executive branch in this time of war. And it's very similar, I think, to the role that courts play in other cases. I feel, and most judges feel, a special responsibility in wartime cases. We're not doing anything different, but we realize that there's a special burden of clarity and consistency and prudent restraint in wartime cases, because we're reactive, we're just deciding cases, but that's a really, if you think about judges only that way, you're missing the boat, because when we write opinions, I know that officials in the executive branch are carefully studying what we say, so we have to be not just reactive and decide cases, but write opinions in a way that the executive branch can understand where those lines are, so that they want to, when they want to go up to the limits of their legal authority, they can understand where they are. So I say, generally, courts have a role, decide the cases essentially with the same tools and approach that you decide other kinds of cases. Did the executive violate the statute, et cetera? In writing our opinions, clarity, consistency, try as best we can to make the rules of the road clearer going forward. Thank you.
Lord Kerr, can I turn to you for commentary on this kind of most central question, I guess, that's going to be driving our entire discussion this morning?
Well, let me start by echoing the expressions of gratitude and appreciation of the other members of the panel for the opportunity to participate in this, what the Dean, I think, rightly and in no sense exaggeratedly described as a day of significant moment. By way of preamble to addressing directly Sam's question, let me say as emphatically as I can that I do not believe that the role of the courts is diminished, and its abundant obligation of our courts, both in the United Kingdom and in the United States, and indeed in Israel, to guard against any erosion or diminution of the court's role in the oversight of national security. It seems to me that our citizens require no less of us, and our societies deserve no less either. The court's role, as other speakers have said, is in many senses similar to that it discharges in other fields of law. But as in other fields of law, the court's reaction to the challenge that oversight of national security presents must adapt, morph, change, and react to the circumstances in this field as in any other. I came today prepared to talk about the use of secret evidence in the United Kingdom courts, and I'm more than willing to answer any questions on that, but I think it is possible to confront Sam's question directly by picking up on a number of resonant highlights in the thoughtful and thought-provoking presentation by Mr. Inglis. The first of these was that the national security agencies and the courts should lean towards each other rather than find themselves in remorseless chronic opposition. There are, of course, a number of endemic, not to say congenital, challenges in meeting that laudable, not only laudable, but essential goal. One of those is the inevitable constraint that necessarily attends the explanations that national security agencies can provide to the courts. And the fact that often, as the deputy director put it, only illustrative as opposed to enumerative explanations are possible is one of those deep-seated problems. And into this already turbulent mix must be poured the further ingredient of the importance in recognizing that courts fill a role beyond merely ensuring that the controls on national security agencies are effective. And they fill a role beyond even that articulated by Chief Justice Roberts of holding the ring or being the umpire between the due process of law and the protection of national security. The courts stand as a bulwark for the maintenance of the rule of law, and not only the maintenance of the rule of law, but the preservation of the confidence of the citizens of our countries in that central feature of an enlightened and liberal democracy. And those important roles for the court are fulfilled by tools which the courts in the United Kingdom and the United States bring to the task, although they are formulated, as the Deputy Director explained, somewhat differently. I'd like to speak a little about the principle of proportionality to which he alluded. We in the United Kingdom, of course, do not have a written constitution, but these issues are frequently decided in the bear pit of challenges to executive decisions as tested by their compatibility with the European Convention on Human Rights. And the principle of proportionality comes into play when qualified rights are interfered with by the executive, and it's incumbent on the state then to persuade the courts by the application of the proportionality principle that they have identified a legitimate aim, and not only that that aim must be identified, but it must be well articulated in law, and it must be pursued by a means no greater than those which are required to meet the objective. I welcome and applaud the Deputy Director's acceptance that there needs to be a debate about resetting the balance between the need for security and the need for transparency. In the latter, of course, the courts will play a significant role. And without wishing to appear trivial about it, the need to ensure that the government does not ask of the courts more than it needs has a cosmetic as well as a precedent dimension. And I give as an example a recent case decided in the Supreme Court of the United Kingdom of Bank Millat. In that case, it was alleged that an Iranian bank had had financial dealings with agencies within Iran, which promoted nuclear research. And a freezing order was made by the Treasury in London, requiring all financial institutions to cease financial dealings with the Iranian bank. A closed hearing in which certain evidence was given to the judge in the absence of Bank Mellet's legal representatives took place, and he gave both a closed and a written, closed and an open judgment. The case then went to the Court of Appeal, which looked at the judge's closed judgment and said that it didn't need to rely on the closed judgment, and it delivered an open judgment dismissing the bank's appeal. The matter then came before us in the Supreme Court, and there was an argument, first of all, as to whether or not we should convene in closed hearing. And by a majority, it was decided that we should. The issue then arose whether we should inspect the Court of Appeal's closed judgment. And by a bare majority, we decided that we should. It was, I think I can say, a decision which all of the court regretted, because it transpired when we read the closed judgment that it added nothing of material significance to the reasons which had been articulated by the the first instance judge and the Court of Appeal judgment for dismissing the bank's appeal. And what that illustrates is that the government does well to avoid asking more than it needs to obtain. Because the demand, as it seems to me, that we should look at the closed material in that case has devalued the worth of future claims. It naturally inspires skepticism on the part of the courts, and it seems to me that it will inevitably create difficulties for the government in similar situations in the future. I give that example as perhaps an extreme instance of this confrontation rather than the leaning towards each other that we should aspire to as institutions of government, both the executive national security agencies and courts. But I recognize that there exists and will continue to exist at the interface between those charged with the protection of national security and the courts who see themselves as the guardians of civil liberties and human rights, there exists intractable problems. And I also recognize that the best solutions will always be, or the most achievable solutions will always be optimally less than completely perfect. But that, as it seems to me, prompts the imperative that we strive together to ensure that the solutions are the least imperfect or as near perfect as we jointly can make them.
Thank you very, very much. And Lord Kerr, we will certainly return to the theme of secrecy momentarily, because I think that's one of the great structural questions about the role of a court in respect to the management or to the oversight of national security, how to reconcile the court's natural and justifiable tropism towards transparency and openness on the one hand with the claimed need for secrecy and national security. But let me just stay with this more basic fundamental question for one more moment or for one more round of interactions with the jurists on this panel before we turn more frontally to the question of secrecy and really come at the same question in a sense from a somewhat different angle, and that is the angle of expertise and deference. And maybe I can begin with President Beinisch and pose the following question to you, but really it's a question for everyone on the panel. Your court has really undertaken an unprecedented, sustained engagement with national security issues, has issued opinions on the merits, on targeted killing, on interrogation methods within the intelligence services, on the precise location of a security fence that separates Israel from the occupied territories, on a host of issues that present themselves during the prosecution of active combat operations. So an extraordinarily deep and sustained engagement with national security. And throughout the jurisprudence of the Israeli court on these issues, in your opinions and the opinions of Justice Barak, your predecessor as president of the court, one reads the following line again and again. Our court expresses a view about the merits of these cases because they present fundamental questions of law. However, our court does not purport to substitute its judgment for the judgment of the national security official whose ultimate responsibility it is to decide what the situation warrants from a national security standpoint. So my question to you, and really for the entire panel, is thinking about the question of deference, the question about expertise, the question about the role of the court in confronting not just national security, but the claims of national security officials, which is what Lord Kerr was just talking about. How does a court do that? How do you do that?
Well, first of all, it's not easy. After what I said before, that, and we all said, and we all shared the same view, that national security is not different from other issues that the court takes upon itself to review. Of course, there is a problem of the responsibility that you take when you hear security experts explaining how vital their the steps that they take for our security. And you feel a kind of responsibility to, I wouldn't say, you said, Chris, to intrude. I don't think it's intruding, but I think it's really to check it on the merits, which is a kind of, well, we always take responsibility as judges on any matter, but this is a kind of responsibility when you have to decide, well, what are we doing now when we heard a military general, a military commander, we heard the head of the security service explaining how vital it is. Well, like every other witness, we have to review it. We have to go into the matter, not to be afraid of it, to understand that they have the advantage of expertise, no doubt. They are the experts. So we have, you know, the line is, we are not interfering with policies. If you mention the fence, the security fence, we accept that the fence was the solution that the military commanders with the government selected for securing this at this time, not to interfere, not the filtration of suicide bombers. We don't say, well, a fence, we have a better idea. It's not a fence, you should do something else. This is policy matters, and this is the expertise. But how to put the fence, how to minimize the violation of the rights of the population when you take their land for that, this is our expertise. What is really the main issue that we see is how much, and we here come, as Lord Kerr said, the principle of proportionality. Are you proportionate in what you're doing? Are you not exaggerating in infringing upon rights of people just because you want to be 100% secure? So I think we had hundreds, if not thousands, of cases like that, really. And the thing is not to be afraid of dealing with it, not to be afraid of seeing and not to interfere with policies that they are really the expertise and the responsibility and the accountability of the military and the executive branch. We don't take it from them. We can't take it from them. We respect the separation of powers. But this doesn't mean that we cannot review. This doesn't mean that we cannot see our part in controlling and reviewing the policies. Accepting the policies, this is a matter. I mean, we don't have exactly the political question. We don't have the all those bars, as I said, before we accept the opinion. But we may weigh this opinion like every expert opinion that we have, and we see if it's convincing, if it's really what is needed, because what is needed is the first rule. Is it really needed, and is it proportionate? And those are our tools, and I think we managed to do that. Thank you.
Justice Abella and then Judge Kavanaugh.
Can I just say this is probably the best moment to say that when our country started looking at how to deal with the criminal, the anti-terrorism provisions that became part of our criminal law, the first country's jurisprudence that we looked to was Israel's. I mean, it is always interesting for some of us from other jurisdictions to hear the pillow fight, should you look at foreign law or not? Mm-hmm. It makes absolutely no sense. The answer for us is duh. Of course you're going to look at what other jurisdictions are doing. There is a universality to the issues, and so we want to know what other countries who have experienced it have done in this area. And so we turned very early and very consistently to the jurisprudence of Israel, and in particular Aaron Barak and Dorit Beinisch, where we found very important mantras, like you had September the 11th, we've had September 11th, 12th, 13th, 14th, and democracy fights with one hand tied behind its back. So it was a very important framework for us as we were heading into our deliberations on these cases to know that the court that had September 11th, 12th, and 13th, the consistency and the tenacity of these kinds of security issues all the time, was nonetheless able to transcend the quotidian and create a jurisprudence that overridingly protected rights. So I say that first in acknowledgement to what you have done, your colleagues have done, and we think in the rest of the world who are comparativists, and I think that's most of the rest of us, are very grateful for what you've done. Secondly, I think the rhetoric of war in discussing security issues is not helpful. It's a way of avoiding responsibility for what judges are supposed to do, because when you put an interim framework around an issue, then everybody says, oh, this is, you really better defer because they've got the expertise and the consequences of your getting it wrong are really horrifying. So war on terror, war on drugs, mm-hmm. I find that language as a judge particularly unhelpful. It doesn't tell me anything except that a lot of people are worried about it, but so are we. And so finally, what does that say about our role in looking at expertise? Well, one of the things that judges do, aside from looking sideways, we have judicial modesty because we know we are not expert in all things. We put together things from different places. We learned about proportionality from the German Constitutional Court and from the Israeli Constitutional Court, but we also look at the past. So we looked at the history of the way security issues have been dealt with, particularly in the United States and in my own country, and see that there has been an historic tendency to overreact, which has proven over time not to have been the right approach in the circumstances. So we learn from looking backwards. Don't let your palpitating heart dictate what the law is going to be. We look sideways, as I said, to see what other jurisdictions are doing. And we do it all in order to look forward and decide what legacy are we going to leave for the next generation in the protection of rights. And so, yes, we defer to expertise, but the expertise on the protection of rights is ours. That's what the public has assigned to us. Responsibility, not just for drawing lines with respect. I don't see the judge's role as being an umpire. That's easy. That's contracts. That's torts. That's maybe even criminal law. But when you're dealing with constitutional issues, you are making law. And let's stop pretending that interpreting law and making law are totally different animals. When you interpret law, you make law. And that's a judge's job to make law. We're common law judges. How do you think the law of contracts and torts got developed by judges? So I think if we strip away some of the rhetoric from what is really going on, you've got judges in constitutional courts around the world very conscious that they have an obligation not just to the moment and to the public, but to the future and the public.
Justice Abella, you're making my job as moderator exceptionally easy.
That's my job. I'm a Canadian. We're very nice.
Because I think what I need to do now is to be an umpire, disappear, and let the game proceed. Without further ado, Judge Kavanaugh.
Well, it is a war. There is, as a matter of law in the United States, there is an authorization for use of military force that was passed by Congress, signed by the President, that has no time limit in it, and that is in effect as of today, and distinguishes the war, what I'd say the war against Al-Qaeda, the Taliban, and associated forces, distinguishes that war from the rhetorical war on drugs. This is a legal, authorized, congressionally authorized war for which wartime authorities are invoked. And on the question, therefore, or the follow-up question of overreaction that was raised by Justice Abella, and certainly I understand that point of view, but I don't think it's for the courts to decide that the Congress and the President have overreacted or underreacted to a threat. That would be inconsistent with my vision of the role of a judge in our constitutional system. I don't think it's, to put a finer point on it, I very much disagree with the idea that judges could create new rights or expand rights beyond what they otherwise might say simply because we find something distasteful or we think there is an overreaction going on. So I'm very much against the idea, and I don't think our courts have thus far plunged ahead in wartime into the idea of playing that kind of more affirmative role. At the same time, and this some of this gets into the semantics and you have to go down to particular cases, at the same time, as Justice Abella and the other panelists have said, just because it's war, and it is war, but just because it's war doesn't mean that the courts go away. And to reiterate what I said before, I view the court's role to hold true the balance. And it's not that we're pushing it back against the executive because of our own policy views. What I view is going on in the majority of cases is we're holding true the balance that Congress and the limits that Congress put on the executive branch. So Congress put limits on how military commissions could work. Congress put limits on interrogation and surveillance. And so what I think, and then the Constitution itself steps in a more limited way and has some restraints that apply in wartime. So I think just because it's war, and it is war, does not mean that the courts go away. We hold true the balance in those cases as well. And going to Sam's original question, even when we're told, by the executive branch, this is really going to hurt us in our wartime effort if you read the statute that way, I view that as still my job to say, well, that's the way the statute reads, and it's my job to hold true to the statute. And if there really is the effect you're talking about, please go to Congress and have them change that law. But I am not going to ignore the law or distort the law simply because of consequences that are being invoked by the executive branch in a particular case.
But you interpret the law, do you?
I do interpret the law. Yes, I'm trying to interpret it as fairly as I can, as written. And it's not, frankly, in statutory cases. I know it sounds trite, but believe it or not, the philosophy of just trying to interpret the law as written gets you a long way, I think, in many cases. And I realize the criticism of the umpire analogy, but in a lot of cases, that does it for you. And in those cases where it doesn't, you're still striving to get, maybe there's no perfect answer, but it certainly narrows the range of potential answers, and you're still striving to perform an umpire-like role. I don't want to be in the position where I say, boy, the country's overreacting, therefore I'm going to read this statute more broadly. I don't, that premise would not be part of, I hope, and certainly try to fight against it of my mindset, nor the country's underreacting, and therefore I need to loosen, or the Congress has overdone it in putting restraints on the executive. That shouldn't be my mindset either. I shouldn't be ignoring the restraints that Congress has put in there on the executive.
Let's pivot for a moment to secrecy, and let me begin with a provocation to thought, and it's intended to be a provocation that tracks the dual mandate of the Center on Law and Security, which is to track the strategic and the legal issues alongside one another. So here would be my provocation. If you considered the news over the last days, weeks, let's say year or two, you might observe the following. Whereas national security officials, and intelligence officials in particular, individuals like Chris Inglis or his counterparts in the United Kingdom, are becoming more accessible in the media. I noted with my students in class last week that the very first time that the heads of MI6, MI5, and the British counterpart agency to NSA appeared together for televised testimony before a parliamentary committee was in November of this year. It had never happened prior to that. So whereas intelligence officials are beginning to understand the need for more transparency within their own professional lives, that courts, if anything, have taken baby steps in the direction of secrecy. And I would put out there, at least as a provocation to thought, the closed material procedures that Lord Kerr had already referenced. Justice Abella, I know there's a case pending in Canada that implicates the same question. And certainly the issue of secrecy and adjudication is not alien to the Supreme Court of Israel or to the DC Circuit Court of Appeals, let's say in the post-Boumediene habeas jurisdiction of that court. So am I right? Is it really the case that whereas security officials are beginning to come out into the light of day, that courts are allowing some of the secret and the dark into their courtrooms? And even if I'm wrong, you know, how to strike this balance? So maybe Lord Kerr, I know you, you have thoughts about this that you wanted to share.
Yeah, well, it's a very interesting counterpoint to suggest that while the national security agencies are becoming more transparent, the courts are becoming more opaque. And attractive though that formulation is, I don't think that it really holds true. But I hope I can be forgiven for returning very briefly to the question of deference, because it's a bit of a hobby horse of mine. I think deference is an outmoded concept if it can be dignified with the description of concept. And certainly, I think it's been a misnomer from the beginning. There's no question of the courts deferring to government, nor of the government or indeed national security agency deferring to the courts. It's a question of each of us recognizing the perimeters of our own jurisdictions, the jurisdictions that we each occupy. And the role of the courts, in very crude, simplistic terms, can be described as a role which is a vouching or verifying one to ensure that the decision under challenge can withstand the attack that its apparent conflict with a constitutional or civil right is viable. National security decisions, by definition, must be taken on a far broader canvas than that on which the tension between national security issues and the civil liberty debate takes place. But courts do perform, in my view, a salutary effect in encouraging, and I heard resonances of this in Mr. English's speech this morning, in encouraging the proofing of national security decisions by adherence or their ability to withstand civil liberties or human rights challenges. In a somewhat different context, a former colleague of mine, Lord Hoffman, said that decisions by government can be contrary to fundamental human rights. Part of the role of the court is to ensure that the principle of legality is adhered to. And the principle of legality in this case requires that the government must, if it decides that it's going to legislate or take a decision which is in conflict with fundamental human rights, must squarely confront what it is doing and accept the political cost. Now, having vented my spleen on that, let me return to Sam's question. He referred to the appearance before a parliamentary committee of the three heads of the various national security agencies in the United Kingdom. And I, as a citizen, not as a judge, welcome that development, of course. And it seems to me that it partakes of the very transparency that Mr. English was accepting, that in the resetting of the balance we hope as a society to achieve. But as I said, I don't accept the counterpoint that the courts are becoming more opaque. The Justice and Security Act of 2013, which was enacted following a decision of the Supreme Court in conjoined cases of Al-Rawi and Tariq against the Secretary of State for the Home Department, now requires all courts in the United Kingdom, if requested to do so by the Secretary of State, to decide whether to hold a closed hearing. I have considerable reservations, which I expressed in my concurring opinion in the Al-Rawi case and my dissenting opinion in the Tariq case as to the philosophy which underlies this. But the courts, certainly not of their own initiative, are becoming more secret. And we have, I hope, articulated, and if I can, I will continue to articulate, the philosophical dangers which lie in inviting courts to convene into secret hearings. I've already referred to the Bank Mellat case. In the Tariq case, we were concerned with an immigration officer who was dismissed from his post because, as it transpired, his brother and cousin were suspected of being involved in terrorist activity. Much of the material that was withheld in the initial stages of that litigation proved in the event to be entirely innocuous. We have a system in the United Kingdom where In the course of closed hearings, special advocates are appointed to represent the interests of the person who is involved in the litigation, a party to the litigation, but who will not hear or participate in the hear the evidence or participate in the exchanges that, during the closed hearings. And one of the very distinguished group of lawyers who staff this special advocate system, a man called Martin Chamberlain, and who acts frequently as a special advocate, has written an article in which he explains in great detail the difficulties that a special advocate has in properly representing his client's case. This is an instance, however, of the less than perfect solution that we both have to strive to come up with in order to mitigate the effects of participating in a system which does not provide open and transparent justice. And despite what I've said earlier, I accept that there will be occasions when that must take place. But we as judges need to ensure that the government and the national security agencies are put to their mettle to persuade us that this is required. And it seems to me as well that there needs to be a very clear recognition that a judge who's called upon to decide often fundamental constitutional issues on questions which have not been tested by a challenge by the opposing party will inevitably, on occasions, get it wrong. It's a myth to believe that because the judge is given all of the information, he will necessarily take a better decision. Decisions which are the product of evidence which has not been the subject of challenge carry the potential to wholly mislead the tribunal which takes the decision. And that's something which I think we will have to continue as judges and as government agencies to debate into the future.
Justice Abella, did you want to come in on the question of secrecy and adjudication?
I would, and I wanted to point out that among the judges in the UK Supreme Court who is the most rigorous in defending these kinds of rights is the judge I met in Northern Ireland who is dealing with this constantly, and yet, rather than yielding to these fears, he's been developing a very strong and helpful for us jurisprudence in the protection of rights. So transparency and closed hearing. I mean, it's interesting to hear a discussion about how the courts are creeping towards more secrecy. I think we have to put this in chronological context. The courts always creep because they never do anything quickly. So we got provisions in 2002 which said you could have closed hearings. The first time we ever had one was in November. So it's the first and only time, which raises a number of questions.
First and only time, just to be
that the Supreme Court
that your
Canada,
own court closed own its Canada. Doors to the
but
public.
Let me come to that in a moment. Okay. So when Sharkawi 1, I think you know Sharkawi 1, Sharkawi 2, Harkat, those are our big security cases. When it came before us, the constitutional challenge was to the fact that there was secret information to which the Sharkawi, Harkat were not entitled. We had by then experienced Arar. I'm sure you all know about Arar, where incorrect information resulted in a Canadian citizen being renditioned to Syria, tortured for a year, and brought back. We, as a result, had a public inquiry into all of that. In that public inquiry, the judge in charge of it used a British system of special advocate to mediate between the possibility of keeping some information closed and some information public. So the person who is Sharkawi has his own lawyer. The special advocate is somebody who knows more than Sharkawi's lawyer. The designated judge knows everything. And so when we saw what they did in the Arar inquiry, in order to make sure that Arar knew what he needed to know in order to participate fully, we recommended in Sharkawi that there not be a blanket preclusion of secrecy, but that there would be an optimal opportunity for people to know what the case was against them. So we struck down as unconstitutional the provisions that made it closed, and then we got Sharkawi 2. Now, Sharkawi 2 was a question of whether or not the provisions of the Terrorism Act, which said you got to have a religious purpose, violated the Constitution, but that was a different issue. What we got in Harkat was a presentation to the court of a closed hearing. Nobody challenged the constitutionality of Section 83.1c, which said, at the minister's request, some evidence can be heard in secret. So we are not roving white knights with a Klieg-like looking for injustice. When we are invited to consider the constitutionality of a provision, we do so very happily and very robustly. But we were presented with a consent from all parties that one day of the two-day hearing take place in secret. What would we do if somebody asked us to challenge, to scrutinize the constitutionality of that provision? I don't know. But what we heard in that second day, closed hearing, was evidence in the presence of the special advocates that Harkat did not hear. The decision hasn't come out, so I'm not going to tell you whether we think that's a good thing or a bad thing. But we do try to mediate the demonstrable need for secrecy when it exists with the demonstrable need of the parties to know as much of the case against them that they can meet it fairly. Let me segue into one final comment, and that is about the use of the phrase the rule of law. It's my thing that the rule of law is just not a helpful phrase, because in my generation, it was how we had apartheid, segregation, the Third Reich. And so I just urge in this room full of very intelligent people that we think about replacing the rule of law under which the judges in the Third Reich just adopted whatever legislation the government put in front of them with something like the rule of justice, because law and justice should have a working relationship. That's just my little pet.
Okay, let's stay on this theme of secrecy. President Beinisch, your court obviously has enormous experience with dealing with secrecy.
Yes, well, first, I must say, I think that in the future, the post-Snowden Snowden era and other things and the technology we have to reconsider what is really secret and what is not, because the technology enables people to know so many secrets that then we have to think what are the real secrets, and I believe we still have real secrets because, of course, security agencies could not function without the secrecy. But I think our what is privacy today and what is secrecy today should be considered in the next years. The other thing, I of course agree, it's not enough, the rule of law, and the problem of secrecy is a serious problem for us because we are all courts that we have the adversary system, which means we are used to work with two parties. We feel very bad when we have to, I think all of us, to see material, secret material, without the other party, and to decide. It's very difficult for a court that usually works under the adversary system. So in the UK and in Canada, you adopted the special advocate, which in a way, it's a relief for the court. I'm not sure that this is a relief for the defendant or the detainee, because he is not allowed to know anyway what's going on. But for the court, you share the responsibility when you see the secret evidence, and someone else also saw the secret evidence and could ask questions that maybe you didn't ask. So this is part of the role of a special advocate. So we didn't introduce the special advocate. I think we should have for very complicated cases. But normally, if you think how many cases of detainees, and you know all the detainees that are held under administrative detention in Israel, in the territories, not in Israel, by the military, they have access to the Supreme Court, which means that we review sometimes almost hundreds of cases, or not hundreds is exaggerated, but many, many cases. If we will have to use this procedure, it would be, they will be released until we finish the work. So we have, on the basis of consent, if two parties, if the people who represent the detainee or the person who is the petitioner in the court agrees, the court sees the material ex parte. Mm-hmm. Only the court sees the material. Of course, we could lift the secrecy. This is our discretion. But I think sometimes we are really bothered about it. But sometimes we feel the trust of the petitioner who says, I ask you to see the material. I want you to see the material, the secret material, even ex parte. This is a feeling that they do trust the court, and which is, in my view, very, very important. Anyway, this, I don't know what, there is no good solution for secrecy. Sometimes we have those closed sessions with both parties, closed for the public. It's easier. This is easier because then at least the person who is involved is not in any secret position not to know anything. But the most difficult, and we have many of them, are those that we have to deal only ex parte. I think we managed to do that. Not bad, not bad. I said it's a burden mostly on the court more than on the other people, because you are not used to it, because you don't feel that this is the right system to work. And as I said, maybe we'll consider more seriously in the next years what is really secret, when it endangers the life of an informant, the life of people which you really have to keep secret, and when it is exaggerated because it's, again, the maximum security that the agencies are looking for. So this is, again, for the court to balance.
I'm going to turn to Judge Kavanaugh for reflections on this question or aspects of secrecy. And as I do so, I also want to put everyone in the room on notice that after Judge Kavanaugh weighs in, we're going to pivot to a Q&A mode here. So if you have questions for the judges on the panel, you might begin to kind of line up at the microphone or to begin formulating your question. And we'll do Q&A for approximately 15 minutes or so. I also want to kind of recommend that students in particular feel empowered to ask questions and don't be bashful. This is a wonderful opportunity to interact with judges from around the world who've studied these issues in very great detail. So everyone on notice, and especially students. And over to Judge Kavanaugh.
Briefly on secrecy, I agree with a lot of what's been said, that the courts should push and have been pushing to ensure that as much is public as is possible about what we're doing and why we're doing it. I think just taking a broader view of it, the country, Lord Kerr talked earlier about the confidence of citizens in the country as being a factor in all that we do in all the branches. And I think when the countries know what's going on, that gives them more confidence. And if they have less confidence, that may signal a need for change in what is going on. So I think transparency in the courts is an important value, one we're pushing forward on. Obviously, there's been a lot of discussion about the FISA court, which I'm not involved in recent months. And more, I think, public explanation about what exactly they do. And I think that education is helpful as well. I would say on the executive branch side, I think, as well, when Office of Legal Counsel opinions are made public, that is generally helpful when that can be done without disclosing sources and methods improperly. And I think, again, in terms of confidence of citizens in the country, confidence of Congress, it's better when things like that can be made public as quickly as possible. So I'll conclude it there and send it back to you, Sam, for the Q&A.
Okay, great. So, gentlemen, yes, please. And could you please state your name and also just ask a question, please?
Okay, Basil Apostle. Is it your understanding, as it was mine when I had a top secret clearance, that 95% of all top secret is more to protect the embarrassment of government officials And as epitomized by the Snowden and Manning revelations, I don't, you know, what do you determine as the expert who declares what is secret and what is not? How
Thank
do you,
you
make that distinction?
I think maybe what we'll do is we'll take a couple of questions and we'll kind of bunch them together. Thank you,
okay.
Sir. Elizabeth Parker.
Elizabeth Rinskoff Parker. I'm speaking in my capacity as a member of the Public Interest Declassification Board. Something our board has become aware of, and it's quite timely to the conversation this morning, is how are the FISA court opinions declassified? You may be aware that this morning General Clapper announced the 2,000 pages of opinions of that court and related documents are now being released. In the United States, the court does not control release of those opinions, and I would suggest that that's a real problem, because one of the things that a court does, I think, most effectively is educate. And when the opinions are not available, that education doesn't occur. And so we're left, as Judge Kavanaugh mentioned, with one 1952 case to guide us, the Steele seizure case before 9/11. I'd be interested to know how your jurisdictions handle release of the actual written opinions.
And maybe one more question, and then we'll kind of bunch those together.
Yes, the key intersection of courts and secrecy, as you've raised, is the state secrets doctrine in the U.S., which has been abused, unfortunately, by the current president even more than his predecessor. And starting out as something dealing with whether a particular document should be kept secret, it's now used to tell the judge he can't hear the case at all. And I'm wondering if there's a counterpart to that doctrine in Israel, Canada, or Britain. The Congress, in the one committee, passed a law to change that and have the judge pay deference but not completely let the executive branch prevent people from having their cases heard at all. Are there comparable doctrines in your country?
So maybe we could start there, maybe on the question of public interest immunity, its relationship to closed material procedures, but once again, kind of returning to this question of secrecy, which I guess was also part of at least one of the other, both of the other questions. Do officials overstate the need for national security and employ secrecy as a way of essentially concealing their desire to overclaim in national security matters? And what about this matter of declassification?
Could I start with saying something about the Justice and Security Act of 2013? One of the proposals in that in the bill as it was passing through Parliament is that the system of public interest immunity be swept away. Probably everyone in this room is familiar with public interest immunity applications, so forgive me for saying something about it, but it's merely just to set the scene. A public interest immunity certificate is applied for in our courts where a minister decides that it's not in the state's interest that certain information should be revealed. Of course, if he applies to the court successfully to withhold that material, then that material doesn't form any part of the adjudication process. So the 2013 Act proposed to sweep that away entirely, and instead of asking to withhold material in the future, the government would simply say, please convene a CMP, a closed material procedure. So the minister didn't have to confront the question of whether it would be better to keep that out of the adjudication process altogether. That part of the bill was defeated as a result of a number of amendments. And now the procedure is that it's not for the Secretary of State to decide whether a CMP hearing should take place. It's for the court to decide, and it may only permit a CMP hearing if one a party to the proceedings would be required to disclose material that is sensitive for reasons of national security, two, if it's satisfied that it is in the interest of the fair and effective administration of justice, and that the hearing let the CMP hearing be held. But the second question gives rise to a very serious consideration that has concerned a number of people involved in this area in the United Kingdom. and that is that a body of jurisprudence is building up which is not available to parties, nor indeed to courts taking decisions on this in the future. And I think that that is something that needs to be addressed very directly by the authorities, whether there should be a review, a periodic review, to decide whether or not material contained in a judgment or opinion, which at the time that it was taken it was justified, should nevertheless now be released in order to inform the approach that contemporary courts take to this question.
Why don't we have some more questions? I think maybe the kind of the fund of questions together we could then employ to return to each of the judges on the panel for some closing thoughts.
This isn't about secrecy. This is about transparency. Okay. My question is for Judge Kavanaugh. But first, for Professor Rascoff, I want to carry the metaphor of the umpire one step further. When we didn't like a decision, we used to say at a game, we used to chant in unison, "The ump beats his wife." So that's what our chant was.
Okay, could you just ask your question,
the question
please?
Is,
thank you.
As in the appeals court, isn't it an example of gross judicial activism what they did with Judge Shira Shinlin and the stop and frisk law?
Okay, thank you for your question. Okay. Professor Strandberg?
Yeah, I wanted to ask a sort of substantive question about how you go about doing the proportionality or constitutional analysis or balancing review of a national security program or provision in light of the question of the efficacy of the program or provision. In other words, how do you take the efficacy, and how should courts take efficacy into account in analyzing the constitutionality of these programs? Thanks.
Thank you. And the final question.
Thank you. John Kim. I would like to ask the panelists to what extent in dealing with these kind of national security issues do you apply the international law to the case? You know, often many cases happening in abroad in foreign countries. And even in the United States, well, there was a recent news report saying that NSA, you know, monitored the conversations of UN employees in a certain meetings and setting. So to what extent do you apply the international law to the question of this kind of nature? If the government argues that this was in the interest of our national security interest, you know, we monitoring all these telephone calls, but that may also violate the treaty between U.S. and the United Nations. That's, you know, guarantees the security of all these employees' activities in this country. So how do you apply the international law in such a case? Thank you.
Okay, and thank you all for your questions. And maybe what I'll do now is, first of all, begin with my conclusion, which is, wow, what an enormously illuminating conversation from the four judges on this panel. And thank you so much for being here today and for being part of this conversation. And now over to you to actually conclude substantively. I think the question of efficacy is a great place for any one of you to begin. The question of international law in domestic adjudication, it's our obvious understanding of the way we think about this threat or these emerging threats strategically that we cooperate one with another and that countries cooperate. So how does the cooperation extend over to the area of law? Why doesn't each of you take a turn either at answering all of those questions, one of those questions, and also concluding briefly, and then we'll have our coffee break before the next panel. Justice Abella.
Let me start with international law. We use international law like rolling out of bed. It applies. We started off being very clear that we were looking at conventions and treaties and what Canada had decided to actually become a signatory to, and then we started looking at international customary law, and then we ran into the problem of really liking some of the values in the international laws that we hadn't agreed to and had some difficulty deciding whether it was, in fact, international customary law, whether it had cohered sufficiently that one could put the label on it and say, yep, this is now international law. So we have come to a point now where we've said, if it's in the spirit of international law and the values that international law embraces, we will use it to inform the way we are looking at these issues. All constitutional issues, frankly, but particularly in the area of security. So that's one. We embrace international law on the theory that this is what nations have decided, democratic nations have decided should be transcendent aspirational values. That's number one. Number two, proportionality. I am so grateful to the German Constitutional Court for discovering this whole concept, because it is now the justification process that Canada uses every time the government is said to have infringed a right. So the very first section of our Charter of Rights and Freedoms, and I think most of the postmodern constitutions have this, is something which has made our life as constitutional judges a whole lot easier than the American Supreme Court. And the first section says, these rights are guaranteed subject to limits, reasonable limits in free and democratic societies. So what do you have there? You have a requirement to balance with what other democracies are doing in order to decide whether the infringement is justified. So when our court developed a test for how you apply the balancing and the proportionality, we look to the German Constitutional Court, although it does appear to be missing from the first judgment that set it out. But anyway, we've corrected that since, given it credit, and rely very extensively on Dieter Grimm and Aaron Barak in developing it. So the first step is the government, if there's an infringement, it's over to the government. The state has to justify it. First of all, can they show us a pressing and substantial objective? That's not usually very hard. Then they have to show that there's a rational connection between that objective, and it's not the objective of the whole act, it's the objective of the limitation. Is it rationally connected? It usually is. Then heavy lifting is done under, does it minimally impair the rights? In other words, does it impair the rights really no more than is necessary? And then you come to the third and final stage, which we are more and more using, which is simply the proportionality section, i.e., are the benefits more than the harms? And if it's more harmful to the right than is really than the benefits of the objective, we strike it down. So we've moved out of the minimal impairment conversation and are now much more heavily invested in whether the government has justified the efficacy in connection with whether it harms the right in a way that shows that the benefits of the harm outweigh the harm itself. I almost hesitate to do it because it's trivial, but in Sharkawi too, we talked about the shredding of notes. It used to be that CSIS, our intelligence agency, shredded the original notes. We've said that can't happen. The question we're left with is, so what happens to a defendant's rights if they can't, the summaries can't be tested against the originals? And there you have remedies like a stay of proceedings, which have been applied, where the source, the named source, refuses to disclose his or her identification, we can stay the proceedings. So we have remedies. We protect the secrecy, but there may be remedies to the defendant. Can I make a closing statement? And that is this. This panel, I reread Brennan's wonderful article that he gave at the Hebrew University in 1987. I urge you to read it because it's a summary of how the Americans have overreacted right from the 18th century. But he ends with, we've got to develop, this is 1987, we've got to develop a global system of civil liberties. And I want to applaud the center and you for this panel for helping all of us figure out what that global sense of justice really means in this context. It's a work in progress for all of us. We learn from each other. We even learn from professors.
Yes.
So I want to thank you for the opportunity to help us think about how we should be thinking about these very important areas. So thank you.
Thank you so much. President Beinisch, some closing thoughts?
Well, first of all, Justice Abella, I would have said, you know, as we say, I concur, I have nothing to add. Because really, I think we, especially both systems, have very similar roots now. I mean, our basic laws are taken, some of them, from your charter. The proportionality test, at last, you came to us, and with a proportionality test that you explained so beautifully, I don't have to add. This is the same test, of course, that we use. As you said, it comes from roots, maybe the German Constitutional Court, of course, and President Barak developed it in our system. And actually, we use it now in every case. This is our, and the most controversial is, of course, the third test of proportionality, is the benefit more than the disadvantage of this move that is taken by the executive. And this is, I think, the same proportionality test that we use. So I think it developed very nice. It develops. Here comes in the efficacy, which is part of the proportionality test. But I think this is an element that the executive has to prove, like every factual information that we need for the case. This is a matter of facts to decide. The efficacy, if we are convinced, it's, of course, of the executive, but then we do try, and sometimes we try to have more information about the efficacy in order to use the proportionality test. International law, we, of course, see ourselves bound by the norms of international law. I want to remind all of us that one of the problems that the international law develops more slowly, which means that it didn't react to this kind of war or not war that we call on terror. I agree with you. It's, anyway, it's a fight. I don't know if it's a war. But international law still has mostly the conventions after World War II, mostly. But we think that you can take the same principles, the same norms, and apply them. And it's customary law, it's conventions that the state took upon itself when it joined and ratified a convention. And we have to remember that today we are more than in the past a member of the global community, and we have to take it into consideration when we apply the norms. So practically what we do, if it is not binding, we interpret our legislation in accordance with the international law norms. So I think actually we are becoming more and more, this is also part of being a global community. You work very similar, we work very similar to you, you are the big sister. And I think this is why we have so much in common, and we should develop it more and more.
Judge Kavanaugh, turning to you.
2 points. First, on the academy, I wanted to piggyback on something Justice Abella said, which is on learning from professors, because there's been discussion in American press recently, what the academy works on matter to judges? And I want to say emphatically that what the academy does in the area of national security and other areas is tremendously important, and we learn from and helps inform us. We make better decisions when we're better informed. So I just wanted to echo that point about learning from professors as well, and learning from each other on a panel like this. Very important for us to understand, for me to understand how different people approach these problems. On a theme to close on from my perspective is, it's common in panels like this on national security in the U.S. system to talk about the executive branch, to talk about courts, but Congress is absolutely central to national security. It is central because the executive doesn't just go out and do whatever it wants to do. The executive is authorized and constrained by limits set forth by Congress. And there's a myth that Congress is very hands-off in the national security field. That's incorrect, from the UCMJ to the FISA to the War Crimes Act to the Torture Act, and then post-September 11th, the Patriot Act and the Military Commissions Act. Congress is deeply involved in national security, and you can't understand what the executive is doing without understanding first the central role of Congress. And so too on the back end, the courts. You can't understand what we're doing, I don't believe, without understanding the central role of Congress. Because again, I don't envision our role is to say, I'm troubled by what the executive does, or I don't like what the executive's doing. I don't view that as my role. I do view it as very much my role to say what the executive is doing is in contravention of the limits put on it by Congress. And so there, again, Congress, very central role in the war that that the United States is engaged in. And so too with international law, my personal view on that is it's not for courts to, for our courts to pick principles of international law and use those to constrain the executive. That's not to diminish the importance of international law, but returning to my theme, before courts invoke international law to constrain the executive, I think it should be incorporated into U.S. law by the Congress and by the executive through legislation or through self-executing treaties, which Congress does all the time. So Congress does incorporate principles of international law into legislation all the time, and then courts can, in our system, enforce them. So, central role of Congress in understanding what the executive does and what the courts do in the national security arena. Thank you again for having me. I've learned a lot.
Thank you very much, Judge Kavanaugh. Lord Kerr, over to you for some final remarks.
Well, on the question of international law, in the European context, there are four possible aspects. First of all, customary international law. Secondly, international treaties. Thirdly, comparative jurisprudence, and fourthly and finally, instruments of the European Parliament and the European Commission. I'm not going to say anything about the fourth because it's entirely irrelevant to this audience. Two or three sentences about the first three. First of all, in the United Kingdom, so far as international treaties are concerned, statutes of the UK Parliament are presumed to have been the product of a legislature seeking to comply with its international obligations, and the courts will therefore interpret those statutes accordingly. But international treaties are not a source of individual enforceable rights. The customary international law performs a broadly similar function, with the extra dimension that, Judge Beinisch has said, they are expressions of the normative standards, and rather than consider ourselves bound, as Israel seems to do, we reflect those normative standards when we are investigating the content of asserted civil rights. Very briefly on the question of efficacy. If efficacy of the program is presented as a basis for the justification for interference with an asserted right, the respondent, that is the defender of the decision, must be prepared to demonstrate that a defensible decision has been taken. But that does not mean that it must submit to a non-merits review. So the court is not substituting its decision on the question of efficacy. It's examining the justification which the government agency presents. I, like the other panelists, am very grateful to the Center for giving us the opportunity to participate in this wonderful conference. Like all of my colleagues, I'm sure, I have what you in America call an overcrowded docket. And even judges must have, in the words of the court, time to stop and stare, provided, of course, they don't do so with a constantly empty mind. This has been a splendid occasion for me for reflection and a renewal of the constant challenge that all of the judiciary must confront of seeking to challenge our approach and asking ourselves the question whether that approach should be revised. And therefore, I thank you all very much.
Please join me in thanking everyone.